Good evening, welcome to ITV News. This is Wednesday night's calendar.
And here are tonight's main stories.
Police want the public's help in identifying a man who was murdered and then lay buried in this field for more than 5 years.
It's been 4 weeks since the body was discovered here. Today, police called a press conference to give the latest updates on their murder investigation.
Also tonight, Brothers in Arms, Kevin Sinfield speaks to Calendar about that incredible ending to the Leeds Marathon.
If anybody ever wondered what the Robborough Leeds Marathon were about, then I think that picture tells that it was about friendship and love and looking after your mate and being there for each other.
After a fistful of awards and worldwide tours, Corinne Bailey-Ray returns to Chapel Town in Leeds for her latest projects.
And we meet the husband and wife team with a combined age of 162 who have another major weightlifting title under their belts. Detectives are treating the discovery of human remains in a field as murder, after revealing they'd shown signs of injury and that the victim was buried in a grave up to 6 feet deep.
Yes, the bones were found by a construction worker in Sutton in Ashfield 4 weeks ago. Since then, a team of detectives and scientists has been working to determine who it was and just what happened to them.
Well, earlier they gave an update on the case and said they now needed the public's help in solving it. Our reporter Fraser Maud has been following developments for us. And Fraser, please fill us in with what we know so far.
Yes, Ian, it was 4 weeks ago today, in fact, that the body was discovered here. A construction worker digging a drainage ditch along this patch of agricultural land right next to a piece of woodland that's very popular with walkers and dog owners. The incident was reported directly to police, and since then they have exhumed the body and carried out a number of very detailed forensic tests involving experts, including archaeologists and anthropologists. So far, they've identified that the body is that of a male, aged between 40 and 60 years old, and approximately 5 feet 5 inches tall. They believe that the body's been here for at least 5 years, but potentially much longer than that. And today at a press conference, Assistant Chief Constable Rob Griffin explained why they're now treating this as a murder investigation.
We are able to say that it is murder for two reasons. The first of those is that the body does have a number of injuries. I do not intend to, for quite sensitive reasons, disclose any more detail about that at this time. And the second reason is the very obvious circumstances in which this person has been found. To describe it as a grave would be accurate. It is somewhere between 4 and 6 feet deep.
So the police not telling us everything they know, but are they any closer to identifying who that murdered person was, Fraser?
Well, Ian, what they have been able to tell us is who they know it isn't. They've managed to eliminate a number of missing people from their inquiries, people who've gone missing in that period of 5 years ago and previous to that. And with particular reference, they say they have now confirmed using DNA analysis that it is not the body of Robin Barrows Spencer. There had been speculation that it was. He's a 47-year-old who was reported missing back in 2004 and has been the centre of a so far unsuccessful murder investigation since 2006.
There has been a lot of conjecture and speculation and goodwill telephone calls from the public suggesting that it might be him. You might say, for very obvious reasons, he is a male of the right age, of the right build, who lived very close to that area, went missing in suspicious circumstances in 2004, and then in June 2006, we the police commenced what we know as a nobody murder investigation.
So the police have ruled out that particular line of inquiry. Are there any other clues that could help detectives in what appears to be a tricky case?
It is indeed, yeah. But the police are still waiting back on some forensic examinations, including radiocarbon dating, which will give potentially a much clearer picture as to how long the body has been here. In the meantime, items which were recovered from the grave, including a shoe and a mismatched pair of socks, images of those have been released by police in the hope that somebody may recognise them, someone may be able to give them that vital piece of information they need to try and establish exactly whose body has lain here for at least 5 years. Until they do get that key breakthrough, though, the mystery of whose body this is will remain exactly that, a mystery.
Yeah, real murder mystery. Fraser Maud, thank you very much for reporting live for us in Sutton in Ashfield.
Well, next tonight, it's one of the most iconic and poignant images of the year so far. Kevin Sinfield carrying his friend Rob Burrow, who has motor neurone disease, over the finish line at this year's Leeds Marathon.
Yes, it's captured a special moment between two men, two teammates, two friends. And today, Kevin has been talking about that and the lengths he's gone to raise over £7 million for research into MND.
And this evening, ahead of the release of his autobiography tomorrow, Kevin is at York Racecourse talking about his life and his career. Well, a little earlier, Chris Dawkes caught up with him.
Going back a couple of weeks, that marathon was incredible, but I suppose the image that everyone took from it was that one of you carrying Rob over the finish line. Why did you want to do that?
We wanted to finish together, and it was, the marathon was built on friendship and running for a mate with a mate. It was a really tough course, as everyone will tell you, and the heat was beaming down. Probably took a bit more out of both of us, actually. We had planned to go across arm in arm, but you know, probably realised halfway around that that wasn't going to be possible due to the nature of the day, really. So it was a special moment. It was a moment I'll cherish. It was, like I said, it was a great symbol for the marathon. And if anybody ever wondered what the Rob Burrow Leeds Marathon were about, then I think that picture tells that it was about friendship and love and looking after your mate and being there for each other. I remember telling him I loved him, and what a great job he'd done, because it's worked easy for him.
You weren't just a hero for Rob, you were a hero for thousands out there. I mean, you've given plenty of team talks down the years in dressing rooms. What was it like, you know, talking and rousing thousands on that starting line? Did that come naturally to you now?
I wouldn't say it was rousing. I think what I've found over the last 3.5 years is that it's all right to be uncomfortable at certain moments, because the MND community have got a right fight and struggle on their hands. And I mean, I'm in awe of everything they do, and I'm inspired by everything they do, how tough they are, how courageous, how much spirit and humour they've still got. So for me to be a little bit uncomfortable and speak in front of however many were there, just get on with it. And I'm really passionate about the MND community. I'm really passionate about Rob and the Burrow family. Really passionate about the marathon and what it stood for. And just got massive respect for everybody who took part. I know how much it meant to Rob, and for Lindsay to run it and be incredible. She's like Superwoman doing what she's done, and it was a fantastic day.
What you've done for the MND community makes up the bulk of this book as well. I mean, I read it as a bit of a love story, really. Love for your family, love for your sport, and love for your friend as well. Is that fair enough?
Yeah, that's a really nice way to put it. Rob inspired me to write the book. You know, having done his own, he sat me down and he said, you need to do one. I think you're a great story. And I thought, why not? I'll give it a crack. And actually, there is rugby in there, but not a lot. And I think it was really important to me.
You say in the book, when you go and see Rob, that you say, when I leave him, I'm uplifted and I'm sad. That's two very conflicting emotions, isn't it?
Yeah, and it's like that every time. Every time I meet somebody now from the MND community, I've got a real mix of emotions. I can't get my head around how horrific the journey is. And I don't care who you are, you cannot say you understand what it's like to have MND. You cannot. I love seeing Rob. I love spending time with him. The communication is obviously tricky because you guys have spent time with him. You understand when someone can't talk and you're communicating through smiles. His face, his smile, his eyes tell me a lot more than what you can imagine. I will always be passionate about this. I will always try and fundraise and support wherever I can. When I can't run anymore, then I find something else. Find another challenge, find something else I can do that helps.
Leeds Rhinos fans already call you Sir Kev. I think it's about time that title was made official. But Kev, thank you so much for talking to us, for everything you've done for the MND community and everything you've done for Rob as well.
Brilliant. Thank you.
Oh, and Kevin's book is called The Extra Mile. It's on tomorrow. And you can see at some point later tonight an extended version of that interview between him and Chris Stokes. I mean, what an incredible athlete and an even more incredible human being, really.
Absolutely, yes. I know. Nice to see Kevin smiling as well there, because I know he doesn't get the chance to smile much when he's talking about such serious things, but it is really nice to see that smile there from him too. And while talking of feats of strength, a little later on, we'll be meeting the weightlifting couple, aged 74 and 88, who've just been crowned European champions, but aren't stopping there.
And can this current settled spell of weather not just last into the bank holiday weekend, but into next week as well? I'll have the latest thoughts on that a little later on.
Now, more news now. And an 11-year-old boy and a 17-year-old teenager who were being questioned over a stabbing in Leeds have been bailed. A 13-year-old boy suffered serious injuries after being stabbed in the head and a hand at the Co-op store on Swarcliffe Avenue on Sunday afternoon. The victim was later discharged from hospital but will need further medical treatment. Police are continuing to appeal for witnesses.
Damping down work is continuing at the scene of the latest fire on Marsden Moor. Firefighters from Slowart and Todmorden are trying to make sure that there are no further outbreaks as temperatures rise in the warm sunshine today. The fire, the seventh this year, broke out on Monday. Crews have been using specialist equipment to dig into the ground and get water to difficult-to-reach areas.
Now, a woman who was raped is backing calls to reform sexual offences trials after describing her experience in court as soul-destroying.
The latest crime survey for England and Wales shows one in six people over the age of 16 have been the victim of a sex crime.
The Law Commission, the independent body that scrutinises our laws, has launched a new consultation to work out what changes are needed in order to protect a victim's right to a fair trial. Catherine Walker has this report.
I was told it would be my time in court. It would be my time to say my story. But the whole process is traumatic.
Claire, whose name we've changed to protect her identity, was relieved when her rapist was jailed in March. She waited years to go to court and get justice. But she says her treatment during the trial itself pushed her to breaking point.
It had a drastic impact on my mental health because when you're there in a terrifying situation, an atmosphere where somebody is basically shouting at you and you're being called a liar over and over again, it's probably the scariest thing I've been through in my life. It's soul-destroying.
The latest figures show that more than 22,000 sexual offences were reported in Yorkshire and Lincolnshire last year. However, despite these numbers, the Law Commission says people will be reluctant to report sexual offences or proceed with criminal charges if they're scared of the experience of going to court. After a government-sponsored review of the existing rules, the Commissioner for Criminal Law says change is needed.
So what we want to do is to improve the trial process for complainants of sexual offences. We want to try to prevent rape myths and misconceptions from contaminating the trial, to treat complainants more humanely, at the same time ensuring that defendants receive a fair trial.
The new report into sexual offences trials will now be sent for public consultation. Among its questions are whether juries and lawyers should be given more training to prevent victim blaming.
We hear a lot from victim survivors that the process is really, really difficult for them. There's a lot of misconceptions that are within society that then are transferred into the courtroom. We need to ensure that victim survivors are really at the heart of this process going forward, and they're not being scrutinised or feeling that they're on trial.
But while the consultation is ongoing, the Crown Prosecution Service said they already have some special measures in place to help victims.
It can be a traumatic experience. We are an adversarial system, but there are lots of support mechanisms out there. They can give their evidence behind a screen. We can even clear the public gallery in certain instances, or to give them the confidence to give the best evidence that they can.
In a statement, the government told ITV News they will respond to the proposals in due course. But reflecting on her own traumatic experience in court, Claire and other survivors say drastic change is long overdue. Catherine Walker, ITV News.
Well, anyone can take part in the consultation and give their feedback on sexual offences trials until the end of September. And there's more information on how you can get involved and also support too on our website, itv.com/news.
Now, the ITV Evening News continues at 6.30. Here's a look at what's happening with Mary Nightingale.
Coming up on the programme, Boris Johnson ditches his government-appointed lawyers for the COVID inquiry. It follows the handing over of the former Prime Minister's diaries to police, which allegedly revealed more pandemic rule-breaking. Also ahead, inflation falls to single figures for the first time in months, but food prices are still worryingly high, and it could yet mean further rises in interest rates. And it is the end of sharing passwords for Netflix accounts, but will the crackdown help boost subscribers? Well, join me for those stories and more at 6.30.
Mary, thank you. Now she's won 2 Grammy Awards, 2 MOBOs, and has numerous Brit nominations to her name. Now lead singer-songwriter Corinne Bailey-Rae has taken time out from touring to perform in a special show on her home turf.
Corinne's teamed up with the internationally acclaimed choreographer Sharon Watson at the renowned Northern School of Contemporary Dance in Chapeltown.
Now that is, of course, where Corinne's grandparents lived and where I caught up with her and Sharon to find out more.
3 little birds.
She's the girl from Leeds who made it big on the international stage.
Summer came like cinnamon, so sweet.
Now Corinne Bailey-Rae is performing somewhat closer to home.
It all turns to dust.
In the heart of Chapeltown, Corinne is collaborating with Sharon Watson of the Northern School of Contemporary Dance.
We're doors away from where my grandparents moved from St Kitts. So it's amazing to me to think that I was a little girl sort of walking around these streets and watching the carnival, and now just a few doors down, I am, you know, getting to present work here.
That work combines Corinne's vocal and songwriting talents with the dance expertise of Sharon.
And then you need to turn after that. There you go.
Seeds, Dreams and Constellations is all about aspiration.
What do you want the audience to take away from this?
I really do hope the audience are inspired, because dreams do come true. Our journeys, we're here in Leeds, born in Leeds, we've grown up in Leeds, we've made Leeds our home, and yet we are international. We have no boundaries around what we can do.
It's being performed for Leeds Year of Culture.
Culture is the right thing, and whether it's music and dance in terms of that relationship, which we all know go hand in hand, culture can change lives.
How are you all?
Good.
There's a cast of 50, right, including a live choir.
The musicians are responding to the dancers. The dancers are responding to the musicians. There's joy, there's incredible lifts, and the spinning. The costumes are amazing. To be back in Leeds and to think, you know, this is where I'm from. I know the faces of these people. I know, like, the children of some of these people, and or their parents. You know, it just feels really good and really grounded and rooted.
It all turns to a million points of light.
The show runs from this Thursday until Saturday. Then Corinne heads off on tour again. The message of Seeds, Dreams and Constellations is to aim high, just like Corinne Bailey-Rae,
you might just reach the stars.
Look at you, Tina Gell, getting to meet Corinne. I haven't seen her for a while, actually.
I know, she's really busy. She tours a lot in America, in the Far East. I think she's going off, next month, I think. So, yes, she's still around, she's still big.
Good, that's good to know. And from someone I haven't seen for a while to someone I see every day. Lovely,
yeah,
Kimmy.
Sorry about that.
It's lovely to see you.
It's lovely to see you too, and it's been a lovely day. We've had some pretty impressive highs. Spain or Yorkshire? Spain or Yorkshire?
Yorkshire.
Yorkshire.
Well, we beat Barcelona today by a whole degree, and we've had our warmest day of 2023 so far. Bramham, 22.7, and that beats the 22 that we got on the 7th of May at Thorns Park in Wakefield, I believe. We've got a way to go, though, to beat the warmest May on record for our patch. 1947, it got between 29 and 31 degrees, so that was quite warm. Now, we have had a lot of sunshine across the region today, but last night we had a little bit of cloud working from north to south, especially over the Pennines, but that created a beautiful sunset. So a big thank you to Peter McDonald for this one. This great shot by Mick Atkinson. Beautiful uplighting of the setting sun with that cloud that just passed through just at the right time. And a big thank you to Keith. So will it last? That's the question everyone's been asking.
Will
it? Of course, it's a long weekend and it's half term next week. That high pressure builds all the way through into the weekend. Great news. We've got a little front that's to the north of the UK. It won't really spoil things too much, but around that high, it might just bring a slightly fresher feel into next week. But Monday into Tuesday, and all the way through into next week, that high rebuilds. So a lot of dry weather to come. So what have you been doing today? You've been out and about. Andrew Parkinson has been at the Gazing Ball Refraction at Yorkshire Sculpture Park. Absolutely amazing. There's Andrew. We can see the blue sky and the beautiful spring greens coming through. Michiko Smith, this is her favourite place, very near to her. Down the road and around the corner, Heath Common, absolutely gorgeous. And a big, big happy birthday to Kath, because Alison Rumble and her wife Kath have been to Filey. That's their favourite place. They're from Hull. Keep them coming. Weather photos at ITV.com.
Oh, nice place to spend your birthday, that is.
Hey, you know what, Kerry? Sun's out, guns out.
I'm not getting my guns out.
And I do mean that for a reason.
You do indeed, because we all know that heading out in this lovely weather can be really good for our health, particularly when we're approaching our autumn years.
Speak for yourself. But a bit of bending, stretching and lifting in the flower beds can help get that heart rate up and keep us both looking and feeling young.
I need more than weeding to do that. Well, Lynn and Eric Dolman from Eckington have taken their backyard workout to a whole new level. In fact, they were recently crowned European Championships. Here's Adam Fowler.
A lovely day for relaxing in the back garden, but not for Lynn and Eric.
Well, I've had enough reading, Eric. How about a workout?
Oh, blimey.
3 times a week, Lynn, 74, and Eric, 88, are in the backyard weightlifting. And it's paid off. This was Lynn winning the over 75 female category at the European Masters in Ireland. Eric won the over 85 men's.
Our first international for a few years. Couple of years anyway, and so we wasn't sure what the competitors were like, shall we say, or the competition, and of course we found out we're the best.
Eric's been weightlifting since he was a teenager. Lynn only took it up when she was 64.
It's a way of life, and it's a healthy one.
Makes you feel good, I think, when you've done it. Feel good with yourself, and it's good for your bones.
The couple have been featured on calendar before, in 2013 when they became British Masters champions, and 2 years later when they won British titles again. You might think that now they're European champions, it's time to slow down. But the couple have their sights set on the World Championships in Poland in August.
Well, Lynn's won it a few times. I haven't. And it's funny because the ref said, why don't you get as good as your wife?
Well, I think I might try powerlifting, squat, a deadlift and a bench press. I think that might be the way forward.
With their beloved Chow Tilly looking on, the weightlifting couple are back in training and looking forward to showing the world they've still got what it takes. Adam Fowler, ITV News, Eckington.
They have got what it takes. The little dog was like, what's going on? There's still hope for us yet, you know. Lynn didn't take hope till she was 64.
I know, amazing. I might get some guns one day, you never know. Now then, let's get the weather from Kerry.
good visibility on the horizon. TUI sponsors ITV Yorkshire Weather.
Hello again. It's turned out to be another nice day across the region today. A little bit of mist and morning haze, but pretty much blue sky from the word go across many parts of the region. Just that fair weather cirrus cloud for the middle part of the day, staying dry and staying settled all the way through until the long weekend and probably most of next week. So fine and dry, but over the next few days, variable amounts of cloud, but continuing to stay nice and warm in any sunshine and even at the coast. Average temperatures. So this was the scene so far today. We have got a weakening weather front to the north and west, and that will gradually work its way southwards towards us during the course of tonight. But a fine evening to come, just thicker cloud amounts as the night wears on. Staying mostly dry though, with fairly light winds, and for most of us just about staying in double figures overnight tonight, so a slightly milder night compared to previous nights. As we head into tomorrow, various sun times as we head into Thursday. Big thank you to Tom for this shot. 4:50 and 9:17 are sometimes as we head into tomorrow. So a bit disappointing perhaps for many in terms of sunshine amounts. We are expecting quite a bit of cloud throughout tomorrow. Should thin and break at times, giving some bright if not sunny spells, and where we see the sunshine, 17, 18 Celsius in light winds. We stay dry, that's the focus, and don't let that thinner cloud catch you out. The UV sunburn risk is still high. As we head into Friday, very similar story, although we're hoping that the cloud will thin and break a bit more readily, and therefore the temperatures will pop up to around 19 or 20 Celsius inland. So that sets us up for the weekend. Saturday at this stage looking like the best day of the weekend. Sunday and Monday look a bit more cloud around, a northeasterly, slightly fresher at the coast, and temperatures probably back down to around average.
TUI sponsors ITV Yorkshire Weather.
Hello, summer. Piri sponsors ITV Pollen Count.
Well, dry, settled and warm conditions are going to elevate the early grass pollen over the next few days. Sea breezes will help along the coast, generally low, but definitely up to moderate in the sunnier spells.
Thank you very much for the weather. Very nice. Keep it going, all this lovely sunshine. We love it.
I will. I'll try.
Indeed. Thank you. And thanks very much to Tina for being with me for this part of the week. It's been great. Lara's back tomorrow.
It's been a pleasure. I'm back just after 10:30. Mary is next. We'll see you later.
Bye-bye. Good night.
Bye.